la bordianda la bardianda la bahaya la bordianda la bahaya. He corda bohonda la bordia tala bordianda la bahaya. He la bordianda la. Would you just get into the flow of the Holy Ghost right now in the name of Jesus Christ? Si la bordianda la bahaya. He la bordianda la bordia tala la bordianda la bahaya. In the name of Jesus, Lord, I loose your peace in this atmosphere, Lord, oh God. He kahata la mahaya. He la bordianda la bordianda la bordiata la bordiata ye. He la bordianda la bordiata la bordianda la bahaye. He lo bordianda la bordiata la mahaya la bordiata la bahaya. He la bordiata la bordianda la bordiata la bahaya. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Lord, you are worthy of all the honor. You are worthy of all the praise. He kahata la bordianda la bordiata la bordiata ye. He la bordianda la bordiata la bordiata ye la mahaya. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Father, O Lord, I worship you. He kahana mahaya. I confess, O Lord, that you are my Father and I am your Son. I am a joint heir with Christ, O Lord. He la bordiando la bordianda la bordiata la bahaya. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Father, I worship you. Lord, I give you glory. I give you all the honor and praise and the adoration. Lord, I magnify and lift your name up, your great name, O Lord, that is so worthy of praise, Lord. I do that today, right now, in the name of Jesus. I thank you, O God, for every single thing that you've done, that a spirit of thanksgiving would come upon us right now, in the name of Jesus, that a spirit of thanksgiving, a spirit of thanks would come upon your soul, in the name of Jesus Christ. He carda mandola bordi. I lose liberty in this place. I lose the flow of the Holy Ghost and the presence of God and your kingdom to be manifested in this place, in this atmosphere, God. I lose your will to be done. I lose your perfect will to be done in every soul that is in this place, in every soul that is in this house. Isu turi ma andele bordi iku santo. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I loose the power of the Holy Ghost to manifest in this place, to manifest your glory, to manifest your power. I loose the manifestation of the Spirit of God to be so strong in this place. I loose your authority. I loose your power. I loose your word to be made manifest in this place, Father, to be made manifest, oh Lord, to set free, God, to set free bondage, to set free from shame, to set the captive free, to, oh Lord, produce deliverance. I loose your spirit to have its way. I loose your perfect will to be done in this place. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, there is freedom, in the name of
of Jesus. Where the Spirit of God is, the Bible says there is liberty. Where the Spirit of the Lord is right now, there is liberty from your problem. There is liberty from your financial situation. There's liberty from your hurt. There's liberty from your pain. There's liberty from anxiety. There's liberty from doubt. There's liberty from depression that is in this place. Because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty in the name of Jesus. If you believe that, why don't you just clap your hands? If you believe that there's liberty in this place from your problem, from every devil in hell, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Your perfect will to be done today, that the minds, hearts, soul, Lord, and spirits in this place would be in tune with your will. I loose a holy hunger to come upon every single one of us, a divine discontent, O Lord, a hunger for the word and the Spirit of God. I loose, O Lord, the hunger right now in this place, a hunger for you, a hunger to be with you, a hunger to know you, a hunger to be in your presence, a hunger to be known of you and to know you, Lord, a hunger to be loved by you and to love you back. Lord, oh God, I know you love me. I know you died on the cross for me, but God, I want to love you back. Lord, it's not enough for just you to love me, but I want to love you back as well, Lord. It's not enough for me, oh God, just to know that you died on the cross and to do nothing about it. But Lord, I want to love you back. Lord, oh God, the same love that you gave me, Lord, that it would live inside of me so I could give it back in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I loose the love of God in this place. I loose your love in this atmosphere, Father. I loose your love, O Lord, to mend hearts, to knit them back together, O Lord, O God, to heal the broken hearted, O God. Lord, somebody just plug in right now. Just plug in with the presence of God to what he's doing. If you could just lift up your hands. And if you don't have the Holy Ghost, just begin to say hallelujah. If you don't know what to do, just begin to worship God right now. In the name of Jesus, it's okay to worship. It's in a safe place. You're in a safe atmosphere right now. Lord, I worship you, God. I lose the spirit of faith in this place, oh God, to be in operation, oh Lord, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Teach us how to pray, Father. Teach us how to pray. Would you just plug in right now into the flow of the Holy Ghost? Something's shifting right now and something's moving. Something's about to break right now. I lose liberty in this place. I lose liberty, O Lord, for the flow of the Holy Ghost not to be quenched, but Father, for it to flow freely in the name of Jesus Christ. Sitana Mahaya, Sitana Mahaya, Sitana Mahaya, La Mahaya, La Mahashataye.
Ilotora mahanda la bordia kata la bahaya. Ilo bordianda la bordia sata la bahaya. Ila bordianda la bordia tala bahaya. Ika handa la mo shatana haya. Ilo torima su turima haye. Ilondori iku turima ande le bordi isu taye. Ando le bordi isu tuna bahaya. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I loose, oh Lord, the gift of faith in this place. In the name of Jesus, you can be healed. In the name of Jesus, you can be set free. In the name of Jesus, you can be healed from depression. In the name of Jesus, sickness and disease is healed. In the name of Jesus, bondage and cancer and sin is forever wiped away, Lord, because you have walked into this place. You are the healer. You are the mighty God, and there's nothing, oh Lord, that's too hard for you. There's nothing, oh Lord, that's too hard for you. It don't care, oh Lord, oh God, if it's a earache, oh Lord, or if it's cancer. God, you're able to do it. You're able to do it in the name of Jesus. It doesn't matter if it's a headache or if it's a broken leg, it's not too hard for God. If you came in this place with sickness and disease, God's about to heal you right now. If you came in this place with a hurting heart, he's about to heal you right now. If you came inside with a void inside of your soul that needs to be filled, he's going to fill it right now in the name of Jesus. I want you to lift up your hands if that's you. If you need healing, if you need healing, if there's a void in your heart, if there's a hole in your heart, would you just lift up your hands right now in the name of Jesus? Lord, by the authority of the word of God and the power that is in the name of Jesus, Lord, every soul that is lifting up their hands, oh Lord, by their faith and by your faith of the Son of God, I loose healing to come into their body right now in the name of Jesus. I loose healing to come into their soul, to come into their heart, to come into their being in the name of Jesus Christ. If you receive that right now, just begin to worship the Lord. If you receive that right now, just begin to worship him. Just begin to thank him right now. It's falling upon you right now. It's falling on some of you. Some of you are getting it. Some of you are receiving the miracle right now in the name of Jesus Christ. That's it. That's it in the name of Jesus. That's it. Receive it. Receive it. You don't have to feel goosebumps for it to come upon you. If you believe it, it's yours in the name of Jesus. If you believe it, it's yours. If those of you that just received it, just begin to worship him and let out a shout with your voice. Those of you that received that healing just now, just begin to worship the Lord right now. There it is. There's one already. There's two in the name of Jesus. Come on. Healing's happening right now. You don't have to feel goosebumps. You don't have to feel all of that. For in order to receive it, you just have to believe and say, God, I receive and I receive that healing that you said through the man of God that I'm going to receive. Lord, in the name of Jesus, 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 Father, you're healing people right now. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Ilabordia tala labordia anda la bahata la mahaya. Ilabordia sata labordia kaye. Would you just dwell here for a little bit? Would you just feel after the presence of God, the atmosphere that is in this place? Andalabo, would you just talk to him right now? Would you just talk to him right now? Hikaramaya. You don't have to scream. You don't have to yell. Just start a dialogue with him. Just start a conversation with him. If you're not used to it, now it's time to start.
He's talking to you right now in the name of Jesus, getting your attention. He kada mahanda la bahaya. Father, you are amazing. Lord, you are amazing. And I know, God, you want to heal every single person in this place. But in order for that to happen, they have to come to you and they have to believe it so they can receive it. God, I know you want to do a work, but you can only do it if they desire after you, God. God, I know you're going to do mighty things in this place, but it takes us to be hungry. It takes us to want to know you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, 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 he come on. He labor the anda la bahaya, he da mahanda labor the asata la bahaya. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Lord, by your authority and by your word, let it be so. In the name of Jesus, let it be so, Father. Would you just stand to your feet right now? We're going to worship the Lord in Jesus' name. Would you just stand to your feet and would you just worship him? Would you just let out a shout of praise right now in the name of Jesus? Hallelujah, God. You're worthy in the name of Jesus.
I've got a fire burning. Thank you. pin my pulse with the one, the one that I desire. You're the all-consuming fire in your presence. When I'm at your throne, it's like fire. Shut up in my pulse with the one that I desire. You're the all-consuming fire in your presence. When I'm at your throne, it's like fire. I make it personal, Lord. It's fire. That I desire, you're the all-consuming.
inside of him. Oh, that we will walk together with him in the name of Jesus Christ. All the prayers, oh God, prayed. I release, Lord, those culmination of prayers prayed for him, oh God. Come on, somebody, would you lift up your voice? Would you begin to pray right now? In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Would you stand in the gap? Would you stand in the gap in the name of Jesus Christ? For the will of God. For the word of God. For the end, Lord, the victory, oh God, comes from you. In the end, Lord, the victory comes from your spirit, oh God. Lord, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Oh, Kandala, would you believe that word right now? Would you believe that right now? All things work together for the good.
You
if you don't know what to do, just against you shall prosper, saith the Lord. You're not alone, saith God. He has you exactly where he wants you to be. And that is in his will, in his presence. He's turning it for good. Come on, somebody. Just rest in that word. Rest in that promise. Rest in that promise. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. If you believe what God has done for you just a little while ago, would you lift up your hands, signifying your faith to him? The Bible says, lift up the hands that hang down in this sanctuary and bless the Lord. Would you bless the name of the Lord right now? Would you thank him in advance? Would you thank him ahead of time? That's called faith. Would you thank him ahead of time? God, I believe in you that you have already turned things around. Come on, somebody, would you release your faith? What you have been praying for, what you have been believing for, what the enemy has meant for evil, God. He is, and he has turned things around. He kandara namaya nakasata lamahai. He kandara lalaboko sata lamahai. Ye anda sata lamahai. All things work together for the good. All things work together for the good to them that love the Lord. Anybody love the Lord this morning? Anybody still in love with Jesus? Will you affirm your love towards him right now? However you know how, would you affirm that love, that commitment? As you receive love, as you give love, that completes the cycle of love. For God is love. Everything he does has that motivation of love. It might be very different than how we define love in our limited comprehension. But you can have faith and add to your comprehension that everything that God does is motivated. Some say motivated. The motivation is love. Nothing else. I said nothing else. Nothing else. There's no other motivation. I said there's no other motivation. It's not judgment. It's not to get even with you. It's not to punish you. There's no other motivation but the love of God, especially when you have the Holy Ghost. And it has been implanted in your hearts, the love of God shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, by the Spirit of God. And that word bears witness with your spirit that he loves you. And he deals kindly and gentle with you and I in Jesus' name. How many are thankful for that? He is kind. He's gentle. God is love. God is love. Yoroko sandalaya nakasatalaya na yoroko sitalaya na yalaboko sitalaya. Would you rest in that love this morning? Would you rest in that love all throughout the day, all throughout the week?
all throughout life. Would you grow in grace and in the love and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior? Would you grow in that love in Jesus' name, discovering it every day, discovering it every time. Through the highs and lows of life, God is constant. He does not change. He's the same yesterday. He's the same today. He'll be the same in the future. And everything he does for you and I is motivated by love. How many of you sense the love of God and the peace of God that passes understanding? It's beyond our comprehension. We just go into it. We just put it on. And we bask in his presence. And you begin to sense and feel that love and that peace. And as you stay in that atmosphere of love and peace, then joy will come. Joy will come. Weeping may endure for the night, but joy will come in the morning. It is morning time in your soul. It is morning time. Amen. It is morning time. The sun has shined in your life. It is bright in your soul. It has illuminated your mind. And your ears are able to hear. And God has given you divine revelation in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. You're in the presence of the Lord. This is how heaven feels like. In the presence of the Lord, there is completeness, fullness of joy. And when his power begins to flow through you, there are pleasures forever, forevermore. It's unending. It's eternal. In Jesus' name, because he is eternal, he resides in you. So that's how we fight our battles. That's how we fight our battles. The lyrics of the songs that they sang were not just lyrics to a song. They were words from God. How many of you have sensed that? They were words from God. Paul wrote about that, to sing, making melody in your hearts, singing psalms and hymns, speaking to yourselves. Amen. And God uses our voice to speak to us, to speak to other people, to set in motion things of the kingdom. He says, speak to that mountain. Speak to that mountain. Speak to that mountain. You say, well, it's not moving. Just keep speaking to it. Speak to that mountain until you get a little sign from heaven, the size of a cloud of a man's hand. It doesn't matter how small or big the sign is. You just latch on to your faith. And God has given you a sign this morning through many ways in Jesus' name. And we believe it, God. We believe it, Father. God wants to bless you today. God wants to strengthen you this morning. God has more for you. How many believe that? Wherever you're at in your walk with God, I don't care if you've served God for 1 minute or 100 years, God has more for you. We cannot afford to be static. I said we can't afford to just hold ground, because the kingdom of God is constantly advancing. And the kingdom of God, even Jesus has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. And you've got to have an extreme desire that transcends your situation, and faith that says, God, I know you have more for me. God, I believe you have more for me right now, this morning, in my walk with you, oh God. Even as I get under the yoke, Lord, of your word, and I just keep in step with you, walking with the Lord. The Bible says that Enoch walked with God in the parade of life. If you read that portion of scripture that talks about people being born and then dying, and so many generations being born, being dying, and somebody at some point decided, you know what? I'm not going to join this parade of life. I'm going to join and be in sync with the heartbeat of God and begin a walk with him. And Enoch stepped out of that parade of life. And the Bible says Enoch walked with God, and he was not, because he had this testimony that he pleased the Lord. He just kept walking. We don't know what he did, but we did know that he just walked with God. Can I tell you this morning in the Holy Ghost, you don't have to do anything spectacular in the standards of people's mind. All you have to do is walk with God and pleased with God. And before the rapture, God took a man out of the parade of life to be with him. Because he had the testimony that God, he pleased the Lord. And we know how to please God, right? We know how to please the Lord, right? No, it's not about a set of rules. If that's the first thing that came to your mind, yeah, I knew I'll please God. I got to obey his rules. That's just part of the truth. Because nobody can keep the rules. The law of God is impossible to live by. Otherwise, we would still be living in the Old Testament. But how do you please God? How do you please God? I'm sorry, what? Without blank, it's impossible to please the Lord. I think we need to enroll them back in discipleship class here, number one. Without faith, the foundation of our walk is faith. The currency of heaven is faith. I don't care how dire your situation is or how great it is, you will always need faith every single day walking with the Lord. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is able and a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Would you seek him one more time? And it's not a one-time thing. It's a diligence that he's looking for. It is every day. It is every single moment. It is all the time. He is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. And as you begin to read the scripture, he begins to add that if you become double-minded, well, maybe God will heal me, or maybe God will bless me, or maybe he's mad at me today, or maybe he's going to punish me today. He said, let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. Can you just believe this morning that God is not out to judge you or punish you? Can you believe that right now? Would you lift up your hands and would you just believe that truth? And would you begin to empty your mind of that kind of God? He is not an austere God. He is not out to judge you in this dispensation. He is a God of grace. He is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And when God looks at us, he looks at us with mercy and love and compassion in the name of Jesus Christ. And all he is asking is faith. All he's asking is that we believe in him. The currency of heaven is faith. So how much money do you got? That's why the Bible says the people of the Lord are rich in faith. As long as you got faith,
you have everything. Anybody want to believe that? As long as you have faith, He will sustain you. This short life is not eternal. Faith is the currency that unlocks heaven's door. In Jesus' name. Somebody shout in Jesus' name. Would you thank Him one more time? Father, we thank You. Father, we bless Your name. In Jesus' name. Praise God. Praise God. Good to see all of you in the house of the Lord. Good to see Brother Armando in the house of the Lord. I want to encourage you to keep praying for him. Amen. Good to see Brother Kissy in the house of God. In Jesus' name. Good to see Damian and Lynn in the house of the Lord. We've been praying for them. And good to see Sister Couchman's friend, Farnoosh. Amen. Puna. Good to see you. Amen. In Jesus' name. Praise God. And we had such a wonderful time this weekend. And I want to ask those of you that were able to go or even listen online during Meet Conference to come up and testify. The Bible says we are made overcomers by the word of our testimony. And as they come, I want you to not just hear their testimony, but I want you to realize that it is a word from God. Would you do that? Can you do that? It is a word from God that the Lord has spoken to these individuals, and God is going to use them this morning to speak to all of us. Amen? God's going to use them to speak to all of us a word. God uses people still to speak to other people, a word from God. And I am excited at what the Lord is going to do and going to say. And we're just going to flow in the Holy Ghost this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God. I'm going to kick it off before I lose my voice. God has done amazing things, and I do want to hear from those who were able to attend. And even if you listened online and your spirit was blessed, feel free to join. But I do want to say that we were able to spend some time with Bishop right after the sessions, and I want to bless you with what he said. He said, because we've had a portion of our people come every day and every night, right? So he had a good feel of our church there. He knew, and he was observing, right? He said, your church is not the same as it was 2 years ago. Remember the time he was here 2 years ago? He goes, they are not the same. And I just thank God for the work he has done. And we all know where it starts, right? Yeah, faith is the currency. But it does start in the renewing of the mind. Okay, you say, well, sister, I don't feel it. You know where it starts? What does your mind believe? Currency is faith. What do you believe in? And God has been helping us, amen, as we just need to have that open mind. And I just thank God for him confirming his word, amen, through the teachings and blessing our spirits. Yeah, you'll see up there the pictures from the conference as well, but I just thank God, and we're share what God has done, and encourage the church. And church, if you're not a part of that, if you were not able to come, don't worry. These blessed saints, amen, are going to bless you in Jesus' name. And the ministry will continue what God has started. He will continue in Jesus' name. All right, who wants to? Sister Rachel.
All right, I was able to attend one of the sessions on Friday morning, and it was completely life-changing in the aspect of long before the pandemic, it has been on my heart that God just wants a relationship, not just with me, but with everyone, and that we all have this void in us that can only be filled through him. And we try to fill that void through him, but based upon our prior experiences of how people have treated us in our lives or just the things that we have gone through. But this conference really helped me understand that God wants a relationship with us that is ordained of Him and His purposes. So we need to have a relationship with God based upon what He wants for our life and for us. And so it was just a remarkable experience to hear that and to be able to fill the void that I've always felt just slowly start to close. It doesn't close overnight, and I just want you to know that, because God's an experience. He's a journey. He's lifelong. He changes with us because we're always changing, so He has to reach us somehow. So I'm just thankful to God that, and for this conference, that it showed us how to have a relationship with God through Him, and that our voids can slowly be closed, but it is going to be a process, so don't give up.
Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah.
It was a awakening for me. I felt like I chose Sister Latika. I feel like I just learned about God all over again. And I mean, I've been in this for many years, and you know, we cannot say we know everything about God and that's it, because you don't. You don't. And every time it's a new experience. You get refreshed in the Holy Ghost, and I'm just so glad that I went. And I just want to thank Christy again for letting me bunk with her. She is my lifesaver, and we had a marvelous time. And Sister Latika came in to visit, and we prayed over her daughter, you know, because she was sick. And but I just thank God that it was a new experience for me. It was. It doesn't matter how long you've been living for the Lord. No, every day it's new. Every day it's new. And I just appreciate, you know, Bishop Wright, you know, that God has used him in a mighty way. And it was marvelous. It was. And I mean, I wish I can go back. You know what I mean? And I'm glad that we have the audio that we can listen to. Please listen to the audio. I mean, it will change your life like it has done for me.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, everyone. I'll keep this brief because there's like 12 more people to go. But I was talking to Brother Jim earlier, and we were looking back, and most of what he was talking about was profoundly simple. And the biggest thing was, if it's not in the Word of God, then why are we doing it? And everything that you believe, like, why are you getting baptized? Why are you getting baptized in Jesus' name? Why are you speaking in tongues when you're filled with the Holy Ghost? You should have the Scripture to back it up. Why do we not have a photo of Jesus up on the wall or something, or a stained glass window of Jesus, because that's a graven image? Anyways, just so many takeaways. It's worth watching and looking back. Yeah.
Wow, meet this year was just amazing. So one thing that really ministered to me, Bishop, he said, he asked us a question, said, how many of you have problems? And, you know, I was like, okay, I'll raise my hand. I mean, I have problems. I'm pretty sure everybody has problems. But he said, that was a trick question. He said, I don't have any problems. And I'm like, you don't have any problems? How does that work? But he said, I don't have any problems because my life is not even my own, and they don't even belong to me. And I realized God gave me the full revelation. It clicked in my mind at that moment, but when I got home And I started talking about it to my friends because they asked me, like, hey, how was meat? And I was telling them. And then all of a sudden it clicked within me. It was when you surrender your will and when you cast your cares, that problem is no longer yours. And therefore, you have no problems. And it was amazing because we don't have any problems because guess what? It's not even ours anymore. It's his. And if it's his problem, he's going to know what to do with it and we don't have to worry about it. But it was just amazing. It was a powerful experience. This is a little bit on a different side. I'm glad because of meat because I feel like the youth really got to get together. I don't think we've really had the chance for all of us to just fellowship after service and eat out together and just talk. So it was a wonderful time in the Lord. I felt like I got to know every single one of you guys a lot better. And it was just a lot. It was just amazing. But Dana's correcting my grammar, so I'm just going to give it to her in Jesus' name.
This was my second time in like a meet conference, and it was pretty life-changing just knowing how the previous one was. I thought that I had in my mind an idea of what was going to happen, but when we went in, it was totally different from anything I had thought, and the amount of revelation that he was pouring out and the way that he was explaining the word to us was so deep that you knew that we weren't understanding it with our intellectual mind. It was really God talking to us, telling us about it, because we wouldn't have been able to understand it if it wasn't supernatural, because the way that he was explaining God living through us and being empowered by God in our head, it's like we go through life with these challenges, but he was talking about when you live an empowered life, it's not you doing it, it's really God. And it was amazing. I'm so glad I was able to be there. I'm glad that all of you were able to be there. And I just thank God that I was able to go. Thank you, Jesus.
Sister Jocelyn was able to join Thursday night. I said, you have a testimony because you told me. You texted me. So there you go.
I don't really, I'm not a outspoken person, so I'm a little bit nervous. I don't even know how to start this. I was having a lot of issues at home in terms of, I really wanted to attend the training. My husband is not a believer, as probably everyone here is aware. And I've been praying about it. And I asked him that I would like him to come with me to go to San Diego just to accompany me. I'm not a good navigator. I even text Sister Debbie, to even Sister Christy, to show me how to get there. Regardless of what happened, I kept it secretly. I told my husband I was at work, and after work, I just went straight through the church, and I think Brother Paul, I asked him, can you tell me how to get home? Because I know I didn't know how to get home, and I didn't know how to get there, and I know that my husband wasn't gonna show me how to get there. I'm not a good driver at night. And praise the Lord, his hand was over me. Yes. One of the things I wanted to share with you, I didn't know what to expect in this conference, to tell you the truth. I didn't sit in the front. I saw everyone in the front, and I was afraid because I didn't know what the expectation. But that night, there was a woman who sat next to me. I don't know who she was, but I just felt my whole body was... I felt like I was having a seizure. I didn't know what was going on. But one thing I do know is every night I'm having these dreams that kind of put me in prison. And that night when I came home, I felt the Lord just told me, let go and I will take care of you. Yes. And I felt the words, and you guys know I write notes, so I rewrote the notes of Bishop Wright. And one thing I did understand on that training was that we don't have to go follow the rules. I think for me, I was following the rules of the Old Testament. And without his strength, we really cannot die from ourselves. We really need to surrender and have the Holy Ghost just work in through us to change our heart and renew our heart. And that's one thing I was having a struggle. And that's why I'm having every night the Lord is talking to me, but I don't understand what it was until I actually came to the training and the Lord just revealed to me what he wants me to do. And it's glory to him that I'm free from this prison of my dreams that I'm having every night. And now I feel much more at peace, and I have that joy within me. And I'm just continue to pray that the Lord will continue to have that spirit in my heart, the hunger to love him more, to get him to deeply learn to know about him by studying the words and fellowship and also meditating his true words. So I praise the Lord for what he has done in my life and also as well in my family. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Cool. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Well, this is a change. I don't know what to say. I do have a testimony, but I kind of want to hold off on it because it's not really my testimony.
Okay.
So hopefully you'll hear it in a couple weeks when I go pick up my friend from Arizona. It's really hers. But first of all, thank you, Paul, for driving. And the Spirit of the Lord was very strong in the service. It was just very powerful. It was like a freedom in there. There was like a new look upon the scriptures. I don't know what to say, really. It was just an experience that was unbelievable. I wish I had actually had the opportunity to be at all of them, but due to certain circumstances, I wasn't able to, but thank God he did do the video, so I was able to look at that. I think basically we really need to put ourselves in the Word and know the Word and believe the Word and speak the Word. We need the Word and prayer to guide us every day of our lives, because without that, we're doomed.
Well, you know, I'm trying to think what I got out of this, or what, you know, what I think it was all about. And basically what Lord just told me was that there's a couple things that I got out of this. First of all, it changed my prayer life on how I pray. I understand that, you know, we were taught how to pray relationship prayers and kingdom prayers, and that still applies. It's just how you take it into new level. And I thank God for that. And another thing that Bishop has instilled in me was he talked about the empowered life. And he gave us three categories. One was rest, second was peace, and third was commitment. And contentment, excuse me, yes. And I never forget that. And, you know, it's something that I have to study out. And I am looking and seeking to understand, going to deeper revelation. God has opened the door for me, and now I have to walk through it, and I have to be obedient and understand it and live it as the bishop preached to us. And it was life-changing. I walked out of there, like Dana said, that, you know, it's power. You know, you can't do everything your way. it's got to be, he's got to do the work through his power, which means basically you let him do it. And basically it's not you. And that yoke was taken off.
Yes.
Oh, that yoke was taken off. So his yoke is so much lighter.
Yes.
Oh, I thank God for that, because my feet is so much lighter today in Jesus' name.
It was nice.
It was good.
Other than the fact that I ate too much yesterday because I was traveling with Brother Paul. So when Brother was talking about the will, that it's not our will but his will, I began to think that in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus Christ had to do the same thing. When he prayed, he said, Lord, let not my will but your will be done. So we are no greater than him.
Okay.
So if we can crucify our own will, then we are in right standing with Jesus Christ, and how blessed our life is. So I was thinking that, what if Jesus Christ has said, no, Lord, let my will be done and not yours? Would we still have a salvation today? No, Jesus Christ would not have gone to the cross. So the lesson for me was that I need to crucify my will every day.
Yes.
You have to do that every day. And then where Jesus Christ said that if you're going to follow me, you carry your cross, your own cross, and follow me. And carrying your cross means crucifying your will every day. Amen.
None of us should be afraid of the COVID. It's God's will. But speaking of God's will, you know, Brother Wright, really, God puts it in the simplest terms for us. And God's will for us is to proclaim the gospel. We are to go out and proclaim the gospel. We're not doing the converting. We're not doing the saving. That's God. Our job to be saved is to proclaim the gospel to all, because that's the talent that God gave us. And if we bury it, we're condemned. We're judged and we're condemned if we don't go out and proclaim. And same with the yoke. We cast our cares, but that's not the laundry list. We put on God's burden.
Yes.
Yeah. It's God's burden. We release our burdens to God, and then we carry God's burden, which is to say, you know, to proclaim the gospel. We're to proclaim the gospel. And now if they receive the gospel, and then we can go into baptism, then we can go into the Holy Ghost and everything else. But we don't have to worry about any of that. Our job is to proclaim the gospel. In Jesus' name.
Beautiful. So that was my first ever conference. And I met my friends back in San Diego, and it was awesome. Like, I saw them, I met new people, and then I get to hang out with these guys and I never get to. But then when you come there, all I wanted was to be there. I don't know what to expect and anything like that. But being in that surrounding, like in the environment where everyone is just like strengthening their faith, being there, extending out and stuff like that. But the most takeaway that I got from Brother Wright, because I've been ministering with my friends, and it was kind of like jiggly here and there. But then one thing struck at me is that when he said people who know the gospel, even the backsliders, do you think about the people who doesn't know about it? So in my mind, I was like, okay, like I have to dive in. Like there's more people out there that doesn't know it. And so I just remember like driving back home, me and my sister talking about the whole car ride, because it was kind of like revelatory, honestly. Like everything he speaks about, he's just, it's just in your heart. Like you can't absorb it because he's like here and there, but it's pretty much worth it being there as a first conference. You don't feel like, you get intimidated a little bit, but honestly, it's just awesome. Like, the experience, you never know what you get, you know? Yeah, so praise God for planning that on me.
I don't know, it's a lot. There's a lot to take in, like revelation after revelation after revelation. It doesn't end. I was actually amazed, like, oh, we're done. Like, I wanted more. But yeah, but God changed a lot of things in my life. Like, a lot of questions that I had for a long time, like, God answered it right there. And I was like, oh, wow, how did I spend so much years figuring things out? Like, this moment, like, God, maybe it's a process, you know? God is, like, what Bishop Wright said, that why would you pray to God if, like, okay, God, heal me, God, do this. What if he's just pray to him, like, God, help me get through this. Like, right. He doesn't want, like, to get that thing out of you right away. He wants you to go into a process. So that's another revelation, like, oh my gosh, God may help, God allow that to happen in my life. And then this, that conference, it answered my questions. And I was like, and also when Brother Wright said that, it changed the way I think about prayer, because for prayer, you don't have to pray for what you need, because God already knows what you need. So you have to seek the kingdom of God first, and all those things shall be added unto you. So when I think about prayer, I was just like I don't know, I felt like I was commanding God where I shouldn't be commanding God, because I want to do, it's a sin of iniquity, I think, like, God, do this, God, I feel like I'm giving him a list of things I want to happen in my life where I shouldn't be doing that, because he knows better than I do. And yes. And the when Brother Wright explained about the sin of iniquity, like, I don't wanna go against his will. I don't wanna override his will, because that sin of iniquity will get us into hell. So I don't want that to happen. And about things like, because maybe I was so, I don't know, I have this personality wherein I am not that confident about myself, and especially I think I keep on telling God, God, should I do this? God, should I not do this? And then most of the time, God wouldn't answer. But that doesn't mean that he's not giving you the answer. He would sometimes put it in your mind, in your heart. But then when your brother Wright said that if he didn't give you, like, a word, you just have to, like, you have to feel like you're in peace. You have to follow your peace. If you make a decision, if you feel like that's bothering you and that's not, like, you're having more trouble, then that's probably not the will of God. So if you find peace, then follow that peace.
Wow. Beautiful.
I second the motion for what Sister Keisha said.
Ditto.
I think she already said what I'm about to say. But anyhow, I have a testimony on that conference. On the part three of the session, the enemy tested me. We're about to go to the church, and my daughter all of a sudden screaming for help. And she said, no, please don't go, stay with me. And then I look at her eyes. And I'm not even worried. I'm not even anxious.
Right.
I can feel that he's testing me, this enemy. Then I look at her eyes, then I said, in the name of Jesus, right now, get out in this body. Because even whatever you say or beg to me, I won't listen to you. I'm going to my church. I'm going to serve my God in Jesus' name. Right now, get out. I commanding that whatever pain that started, that pain that night for my daughter. But you know what? When I'm attending this conference, it teaches me a lot how to become faithful and how to fight this test that, you know, I believe is being around for a while. It's just I'm ignoring it. But God and Bishop Wright give me that strength to say that, you know, when you pray, make sure you have that peace. Because that peace is will lead you the answer, what to say, what to do, whatever, you know, planning to do. And there's a lot of experience I experienced in that conference. There's a times that my body was numb and my tears are keep falling. I don't know why, but I know the Spirit is there.
Yes.
Trying to strengthen me and trying to say that, you know, those people who believe and have faith in God, no worries. I will not abandon you nor forsake you.
Yes.
And for the prayers of, like what Sister Keisha said, we are human beings, have these prayers that end up being like an iniquity prayers, like, I choose this Lord, I want this Lord. I didn't know that those are iniquity prayers. But when he say, Brother Bishop Wright said that when you pray, you cast it out. You give everything to him, and he will take care of that for you.
Yeah.
That's the prayer that we have to do. Cast it out, everything. Let him carry your burden in your heart, in your life. And everything shall be given unto you. And don't forget, seek ye first in the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And everything Thank shall be Lord. Added unto
Hallelujah.
You. That is the big verse that we have to put in our heart. God bless my whole church.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Would you worship the Lord? Would you receive those words? God, come on, somebody, would you receive those testimonies? We are made overcomer by the word of our testimonies in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. If there anybody else that want to testify, even those that just listened online, even if not today, some other day, but I don't want to leave anybody behind. I want to encourage you, as you stand, I want to encourage you to listen to the recordings. It's, in fact, why don't we come and bring our tithe and our offering as we're doing this? I do have a word from God, I believe, that he wants us to deliver in Jesus' name. So why don't you just come ahead and give, and if you want to give electronically, that's also possible. But I want to encourage you, especially those that were able to go and not able to go, that you would listen to the video, and it is found on the church's website, stlh.org, and if you click on messages, there's options there to listen to the audio. Actually, no, it's only a video. They were having trouble on Thursday evening, so that's not there yet, but all the other sessions are there, and you could listen to it. It is not something that you just listen and forget. How many realize that? The Word of God is alive. The Word of God needs to be received, and then the Word of God needs to be lived out. It's not knowledge alone. It needs faith to be lived out in Jesus' name. So I want to encourage you to go to the church's website and listen to it. And the good news is Brother Wright will be with us on May 5th, the 6th. You can't forget this because it's Cinco de Mayo. So Wednesday night is the May 5th, and we're going to add another service, which we haven't done in a long time, Thursday night. It all will begin at 7 p.m. If you ever want to have the experience in sitting at the feet of an apostle, like the Apostle Paul, and receive revelation, God will use this man and has used this man of God to have that kind of revelation in Jesus' name. So make plans May 5th. And May 6th, and just before I go into the word, there's also the connect groups right here in Jesus' name. Actually, you know what? Let's come. Sister Katrin, would you come? Jesus' name. And is it okay that you remain standing? Is that all right? If that's any consolation, I'll be standing the rest of the service.
Been a wonderful weekend in our home from Thursday evening until late Saturday afternoon. The word of God was going forth, and meals and everything were scheduled around the services, and we really enjoyed. No one was home but my husband and I, and it was just peaceful and so such a blessing. Well, today is a very special day. This is Pastor's Wife Appreciation Day. Now our, really, the whole month of April, this is you. Yes. Yes. Our pastor's wife is a gem in God's eyes and in our eyes. I've served God 50 years, and I do not know a pastor's wife that I appreciate any more than you. You are a caregiver. You are an investor of people. You're an instructor. You're a counselor. You're an accountant. You're a secretary. You're a social director and an example of holiness. You are many things to this church. We love you so much. You love God. You love us. You work so hard for us. You care so much for us. Today is about you. Yes. All right, let's have a hand for our beautiful Sister LaChica. And here are some gifts.
Goodness. Wow.
Okay, and now your husband's going to speak.
Okay, just please be seated. Promise me you won't do this again. You don't have to. No, really, you don't have to. I love you anyhow. But thank you. And I just, you see, it's God that gives me that love. Because human love has limitations. It does. But even though, even through human love, it's not hard to love you all. You're precious people. You're precious people, but I thank God that he gives me even more of that so I can be an extension of that love, because he wants to love you more and more each day. And if I can be even just a tiny part of that, I want to do that for his glory. For his glory. Thank you for all of this, this beautiful basket and all the good stuff that's in there. I thank you from the depth of my heart. Thank you so much. I love each one of you. Those that have been with us for a long time and those that are new coming in, I love you the same. You're precious, and we're one family, amen. We're part of one family. Thank you, Sister Couchman. I love you. Thank you for all that you do. You've been a mentor to me. Amen. And many of you that are there just serving God and believing, amen, responding as the word is delivered, amen, his rhema, that's an encouragement to me more than anything. That you are believing in him, the testimonies that I heard, that you're holding out to that faith because he wants to be glorified, amen, more than anything, he needs all the glory, and I just thank God for that opportunity and the blessing of the Lord upon you.
Praise God. Hallelujah, 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 amen. We appreciate, how many appreciate Sister LaChica? we thank God for her. And I could say this, that she prays for all of you. I hear her every day praying, every day. That's not an exaggeration. Crying out to the Lord, praying for you, mentioning your names. And she is perhaps the hardest worker that I know in this church. That's including me. She is the hardest worker. In fact, this probably last year of taking on, as God has directed her to teach the Wednesday nights, has that been a blessing? That's been revelatory and God using her. And I just want to thank her, and I know my daughter and son feels the same. We love and appreciate you and all you do. Amen. And God bless you. I pray that God will continue to use you and into this great revival that God has for this church. In Jesus' name. Would you thank the Lord one more time?
Amen. Thank you.
Praise God. Praise God. Now, in case you're waiting for the word of God to begin to be preached, God has already started that with the testimonies. How many believe that? How many believe that? And I feel like, and like I'm going to use Dylan's terminology here. I don't want to put you on the spot. I feel like Faith should probably testify what God has done for her through the conference. And as she does that, prepares for it, give her a few seconds. If you would look up, Brother Allen, Colossians 3:15, in Jesus' name, if you can, in Jesus' name. Go ahead, Sister Faith. We love it. How many appreciate her? Playing every Sunday. Amen. Thank God.
I would say that the biggest thing that I got out of this conference was just a reminder of the things that are religion. Growing up, my parents always taught me this is a relationship, not a religion. This is a relationship, not a religion. But because we're humans trying to have a relationship with a spirit, we tend to turn it into a very formulaic thing. We have a checklist so that we feel like we're doing it right because we don't quite know how to check in with God to see if we're doing it right. And so listening to Brother Wright, he would name things that I was doing that I thought were relationship, but it was religion. I was just doing it because I felt like I should and not because I truly wanted to get to know the Lord. And so something that was really taught throughout all of the sessions was how to get to know the Lord like a marriage. This is a relationship. I don't read my Bible every day because if I don't, I'm going to go to hell. I read my Bible every day because that's his word, and through it, he can teach me things. And so that was just the biggest takeaway for me was this is what religion looks like. This is what a relationship looks like. Figure out how to get yourself here instead of.
Worship him right now in Jesus' name. Yo, rokoto satala mayanda basatala. How many you want to be led of God?
That the purpose of God is to lead us, and he gives us line upon line, precept upon precept. Would you stand with me this morning? There's a word that God wants us to hear today. How many believe that? In the conference is about being led by God, being empowered by God. And this is something new to me. This is what I learned in Colossians chapter 3, verse 15. It talks about, you know, but I'm accountable to Bishop Wright, and that's probably an understatement. But how many of you go throughout your day and you feel, man, well, should I do this or should I not? There's something either that gives you peace doing it or not doing it. Does that make sense? And we do this not knowing that God is using that to lead us. Now, let me qualify this, that as God leads you through your peace, it doesn't mean that it is how we define peace. right? Because that's not how the Bible defines peace. Peace is not an absence of a storm. Peace is having that peace from God in the midst of a storm. So he hides us under the cleft of a rock, the Bible says. So just because your flesh may not like it doesn't mean it's not the will of God. But you have to follow your peace. Amen? The Bible says the peace of God that passes understanding. And God is the Prince of Peace. And that peace is available, especially when he leads us. And so in Colossians chapter 3, verse 15, in fact, why don't we read this together? We haven't done this before. Let's read. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Man, that's a mouthful right there. That is so deep, it'll take you a lifetime to really understand it. And so the Bible says, and let the peace of God rule. And this is what I got. The word rule in Greek, and let me say this, the English is very limited. And so when you study the Word of God, don't just take the English word as it is. The Word of God is only inspired in its original form. That makes sense?
Yes.
The English is not its original form.
Right.
I'm sorry to burst your bubble. The United States is not the center of the world. English is not the center of the world. The Greek is the inspired original form, and the word rule means to govern. It means to rule, to be an umpire, to decide, to determine, to direct, to control, to rule. And so as you live your life, the peace of God is the umpire, the control of your hearts to do or not do things. That makes sense? That's a word from God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. And today we're going to talk about how to be led by God. How to be led by God. In Acts chapter 10, verse 1, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius. Some say Cornelius. A centurion of the band called the Italian band. A devout. Here's his qualifications. He's devout. A man, a devout man, one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. That's his qualifications. Father, we thank you for your word today, Lord. We want to hear your word and your word alone. Would you pray right now in Jesus' name? Would you pray that God will help you to hear his word, to bypass and not see a man behind a microphone, but to hear what the Spirit is hearing and saying to you and has been speaking to us all throughout this service that we have been in this place. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, help us to know what to do, God. Come on, somebody, would you pray? Lord, I want to be led by you, Lord. I want to be led by you, O God. I want to be led by your Spirit in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you believe God will lead you and that God wants to lead you, would you just lift up your faith? Would you just lift up your voice? And would you begin to bless the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, that our tongues will confess that we want him and we're working towards him being the Lord of our lives in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You can be seated if you want. God wants to lead us in Jesus' name. He wants to lead us. Our lives is constantly about doing. It's about doing. That's the title of the message. It's about doing. From the time you wake up to the time you lay down, you're constantly doing something. And if you're not doing something, you're still doing something, which is nothing. But just the same, you're doing something. To do means to carry out, to bring to pass. And the Bible in our scripture text talks about doing someone's wishes. And that someone is God. It's been said that we should seek not our will, but God's will. And you're the safest in God's will. I said, you're the safest in God's will. You could not go wrong being in the will of God and seeking the will of God. In Jesus' name, we've tried our will. Hello, somebody. You've tried to do it your own way, right? How'd that work out? Now, you could either keep hitting your head in the wall, or you could wake up today, God willing, and say, you know what? I'm tired of my own ways. I'm tired of my own will. I'm going to power, and I'm going to believe God's going to empower me to do his will, for it is God that causes us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Come on, somebody, would you receive that? That it is God. You've got to surrender your will so he can empower you to do his will. And so doing is so important, and you've got to ask yourself, how much of our doing is empowered or led of God? Every day, it's an everyday thing. It's an everyday walk. How much of what you and I do or not do is in the will of God? And that's the first step of really walking with God. You don't just check in with him when you can't figure things out. I don't know about you, I don't want to figure things out, because I've tried that, and it is a painful lesson to bring to God something that I've already messed up. Isn't it more wise to bring something to him at the beginning before I mess it up? In case you didn't catch that, before you mess it up. Hello? Oh, and if we be honest, we've messed up a lot of things. But God is so merciful and gracious and kind and loving. Hallelujah. Amen. He said, come unto me. You could trade in beauty for ashes. Oh, mourning for joy. You could trade in the things in life and begin to wake up this morning and say, God, I'm going to ask you every day what to do. What I think, what I ponder, what I plan. In Jesus' name. Why is that important? Romans 8:14, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are, not they will be, they are right now. If you're led by the Spirit of God, you are right now the sons of God. So you could also deduct by reasoning, for God has given us a sound mind, that you are, if you are not led by the Spirit of God, you are not what? You're not a son of God. Right? I didn't say that. That's the word of God. And the Amplified reads, so then, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but not to our flesh or our human nature, our worldliness, our sinful capacity, to live according to the impulses of the flesh, our nature without the Holy Spirit. For if you are living according to the impulses of the flesh, you're going to die. That's the Amplified version. If you could put that up, please. Verse 13, but if you are living by the power of the Holy Spirit, you are habitually, someone say habitually, habitually putting to death the sinful deeds of the body, and you will really live forever. Weiss actually said, if you're constantly led by the Spirit of God. And so it's not a one-time thing and then you forget about it. You don't go about your day and decide for your own and forget about God. It is a habitual thing. It is a constant thing that we consistently do in our lives, because without the supernatural intervention of the Holy Ghost in our lives, we don't have hope to be led by God, because your will and mine, it is so strong that you have to crucify it every day. Amen. Even the man Christ Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, God in flesh, had to crucify the human will to the point where he was subjected to tremendous stress. And we talked about this last Sunday during Easter weekend, that he began to sweat great drops of blood just to surrender the human will. Oh, it's easy to say, not my will, Lord, but thine be done, right? Anybody could say that, but to live that out, it is impossible without the empowerment of the Holy Ghost. Amen? And our lifetime, God is bringing us to that point where we finally really pray and really mean it, not my will, but yours be done. That is the summation of our lives, all of us. Nobody exempted, myself included. Your lifetime, I don't know how long you're going to live, but your lifetime, God is causing us every day to surrender our will. And you have to decide before this life expires, if you want to make it to heaven, that you have surrendered your will, that you have been led by the Spirit of God to qualify as a son and as a daughter of God. And you have to do that habitually in Jesus' name, because we are governed by our habits. Right? If you wonder where you're heading, you just look at your habits. Well, I don't know what's going to happen to me in 5 years. Well, just look at what you're doing right now. Habitually. That points you to your destination, your direction. And if it's not a good habit, pray in Jesus' name. Don't be a victim, hallelujah. Do something in Jesus' name. Take out all the excuses you've been using all your life and blaming somebody else. Hello, somebody. Oh, God is talking to somebody right now. You're so used to blaming somebody else, and you forget to realize that when you point a finger, 2 points to that person, 3 points back to you. And until you wake up and take ownership of your own actions, amen, you're just going to go in circles. But God wants us right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, to take on his authority and his power and begin to realize that he wants you to leave where you're at. Maybe it's even good, but he has something better for you, to go higher in God and to desire more of the things of God and to be hungry for more of him and to do it habitually. It's easy to build bad habits. You don't need help in that, right? I mean, that just comes naturally. In eating, that comes naturally. And gain about 2 pounds being at that conference. Just being there. But it takes more deliberation to build. Psychologists say it takes about 21 or 30 days or 31 days to build a good habit. It's uphill to build a good habit. It takes only 3 days to break that good habit, because our flesh wants to do what's contrary to what is good. Amen. And God wants to lead us. How many of you believe that through our brothers and sisters here that testified that God was speaking to you? If you miss that, you missed God trying to lead you. Oh, that was just a kid talking. Oh, that was just sister so-and-so. No. God uses people to talk to you and I. And perhaps the nearest person to you that you've been shutting off has been trying, God has been trying to talk to you through them. Hello? And so let's look at an example of God talking to somebody. In Acts chapter 10, we talked about in verse 1 Cornelius, and in verse 2, he speaks about the qualifications of a good habit. And here's the qualifications of Cornelius. He was a God-fearing man. He prayed to God always. He gave much alms to the poor, yet he was not saved. He was not saved. And that is contrary to a lot of church doctrines that is being taught today. God's speaking to you right now. It is contrary to what you and I have heard all our lives, that you just got to be good to be saved. If you and I could be good to be saved, Jesus did not have to die on the cross. But you and I need a Savior. How many believe
that as good as you are, your goodness is filthy rags before the eyes of God, and you are a sinner, amen, and if God doesn't save you, you're not going to make it to heaven, and you need a Savior. Somebody shout it, I need a Savior. Come on, shout it, I need a Savior, and mean it and believe it in your heart. Every day you need a Savior. You and I need a Savior. And so here, he's a centurion. He commands people. He's an army officer. He had people under his command, at least 100 people. He's a commanding officer, and he's trained. And if you've been in the military, and thank God I've not, they tell you what to do, when to give up, when to wake up, when to eat, when to sleep. You're GI, government-owned, government issue. And so he has good habits, and he transferred that into serving God. And so he became devout. Devout means he expresses his religious belief. It's not enough just up to a belief. You got to express it. Faith without works is dead. You can believe all you want, but if it just stays in your mind and doesn't transform into some action, it's not complete. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name. And so he was devout. He feared God. Doesn't mean he's cowering that God's going to judge him at any time. No, he had reverence. He had great respect towards God. And he taught that to his household. And then he gave much alms, money, great quantity of money or service to the poor. And he did this always. Right? I know some of you, God's been speaking to you to give. And I pray that you, and you have obeyed, but I pray that you cross over to where when he tells you to do something, you don't have to sit on it for a while, that you just do it. Hello, somebody, would you lift up your hands right now? That when God speaks to you about something, that God will give you the faith to just obey it. And you don't have to debate with him in your mind or in your spirit or how this would affect you or not, how's this going to affect my future. My Lord, God holds your future in his hands. And if you just make a habit of obeying right away, amen, you're going to see great things happen in your life. Come on, somebody, would you believe it? God wants to do great things in your life. Cornelius prayed always. The Greek word diomai means to ask, request, or even beg. All means pass, means all, or so all the time. He prayed to God. He wanted to be led by God and directed by God all the time. And because he has these habits and qualities and traits, God wanted to do something for him. Do you realize that your habits and how you approach God causes God to want to do something for you? Not you wanting from him. He starts telling you, I want to do this for you. You may not even be seeking for a blessing. But God says, no, I want to bless you. And that's the best kind of blessing. For the blessings of the Lord maketh rich and addeth no sorrow. And if what you and I considered blessing today and later on became a source of sorrow, that didn't come from God. Right. Hello? You wanted a new car, now it's breaking down. You wanted a new house, now you're stressed trying to, you know, maintain it. And why don't you just wait on the Lord and let him give you stuff if he wants to. He promised three things. You'll have food to eat if you seek the kingdom first. He promised, amen, that you'll have clothing. He promised you'll have a roof over your head. Come on, somebody, would you believe that right now? And anything else is an addition to the Lord, from the Lord, as you seek his kingdom first. And so here's a man, he's not even asking, amen, but what he did and the habits that he had instilled in his life began to become a memorial before God. A memorial is something that reminds God, constantly reminding the Lord about this man called Cornelius who's not even saved because he still had something to do. And so in verse 3, he saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour, that's 3 p.m., an angel of God coming into him. How many believe in angels? How many believe in angels? Some of you have a struggle. If I ask you how many believe in devils, oh man, I'll just, there's no question there. How about angels? I think you've been entertaining the wrong spirit. You're readily opening your soul to a devil when there are angels around you. Why do you entertain those angels? And the angels of the Lord encamps around about those that fear the Lord or respect the Lord. You build an atmosphere of respect to the Lord. The angels of God is attracted to that atmosphere in your life. And they're going to begin to surround you. Amen. Just like that prophet that was surrounded by the Assyrian army and his unbelieving servants. Says, oh, alas, master, what shall we be? And the Lord... through the prophet began to speak the word of God. Lord, open his eyes that he might see that they that be with us are many than they that be against us. Oh, somebody believe that right now, that if God is for you, nobody can be against you. And so here comes an angel, and in verse 4, Cornelius looked upon him and he was afraid. The first time that happens to you, if it is a bona fide angel, you will be scared a little bit. Your spirit will be upset. But if you tune in and plug into the Spirit of God, you realize he's not here to harm you, but to help you. He said, what is it, Lord? He said unto him, thy prayers and thy alms are come up for a memorial before God. And in verse 6, he said, I want you to go to someone's house named Peter. Here's where he's staying. And I want you to ask him, and when he comes, he's going to tell you what you need to do. Because Cornelius, even though he was devout religious, he was not saved. He needed something to do. Amen? Notice how specific the word and the instruction of God is to the angel. Here's his address. Here's where he's staying. This is the man that owns the house. Send somebody there, and he's going to tell you what you need to do. Do what? To be saved.
That's right.
God was not going to just, oh, he's going to tell you to do it so you could be more blessed. Or you could fatten up your 401k or your wallet. No, he's after the salvation of souls. That's the whole reason why Jesus came in flesh, to seek and to save that which was lost. And he said, Cornelius, I can't ignore you anymore. What you've been doing, giving, praying, being led by the Holy Ghost, it is compelling me. You're not even part of Israel. You're the first heathen, a non-Jew, to be converted. But what you're doing, I can't ignore you. It's reminding me every day, a memorial before God. And some of you have memorials, and all of us need to work on our memorials before the Lord. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. He said, now send men to Joppa. Now, God always uses people to speak to other people for us to be saved. And if you can't be taught, God help you. If you think you figured out life all on your own, God help you. Hallelujah. God still uses human beings to speak to other human beings to save them. Because we can't save ourselves. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. And God, that's why I think God had this today, these testimonies, for you and I to receive them as words from God. Because all of us are tasked to proclaim the gospel. You say, well, I'm not a preacher. Well, yes, you are. Because to preach mainly just means to proclaim. Well, I don't have anything to proclaim. Yes, you do. You've been entrusted with the gospel. You know of the reason of the hope that is in you to give an answer to every man that seeketh or asketh. And if they're asking, amen, you give them what God has done for you, the gospel that's been entrusted unto you, just like it was entrusted to Simon Peter. He was going to give it to Cornelius for him and his household to be saved. Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Many people use that verse and say, see, that's all I got to do. I just got to call on the Lord. Like, how do you do that? Hello, Jesus, I'm calling on you. I'm saved now. That's so ridiculous. Amen. Because it doesn't stop in verse 13. There's verse 14. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? Oh, so calling now involves believing. And how shall they believe in him on whom they have not heard? Oh, believing, calling now, and not only involves believing, but also it involves, amen, on hearing. And then on how shall they hear without a preacher? Oh, calling on the Lord to be saved not only involves believing and hearing, but involves a preacher, another person. Now, I know when I said preacher, you automatically thought about me. I'm not the only preacher in this house. Turn to somebody beside you and tell them, you are a preacher. And mean it. You're a preacher. Your life is preaching something to somebody, be it good or bad. And you've got to decide today what your life preaches. The Bible says that you are our epistles written in the hearts of men and read of all people. Your life preaches something, and sometimes your action preaches more stronger than your words. That's why they say if you have kids, you got to show them, not just tell them. If I tell my kids, hey, you got to pray every day, and they don't hear their father praying every day, guess what? They're not going to pray every day. If I tell them, hey, you need to pay your tithe, and they've never observed in my life doing what I'm telling them, it's not going to work. And people wonder, well, how are my kids doing this? Well, maybe you haven't been a good example.
Lord, man.
I didn't want to say that, but there it is. Swallow it. In fact, why don't you worship and just, it's easier to swallow with worship. Did you know that worship is an anesthesia before the Word of God? Because the Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. It cuts going in and cuts going out. Just a discerner of thoughts and the intents of the heart. And if you don't worship and you're just here for the word, and if you're late, if you come to the word, and you know, it's kind of like going to the operating room and you miss the anesthesia. The anesthesiologist now has checked out, he's sleeping. And you're playing catch up. But I guarantee you, if you worship before the word, you can take it in as it cuts you. Hallelujah. And how shall they preach except they be sent? You know, I tried to find my name in scripture, that Pastor LaChica is sent by God. I tried to look it up. Very expensive software, Bible software. I invested in it. It's almost, I think it's $1,500. I can't remember now. Trust me, I don't buy software. And I'm an IT guy. I get it for free. Amen. And having to pay for this, I gladly did it because it's the Word of God. There's so many books in it in Jesus' name. But I look, my name is not there that I'm sent. Would you believe that? Are you surprised just as I was? And your name is not there either. You know what qualifies us to be sent of God to preach? If we preach exactly what the Bible teaches, if we preach exactly what the apostles teach us, because you could look in the book, and he sent the apostles, and he sent the disciples. And if we preach exactly what they taught, then we could claim to be sent by God. Otherwise, well, false prophet. I don't care what miracles they do. Even the devil does miracles. Hello, somebody. Yeah. And so verse 16 says, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. See, it's all about the gospel. He's talking about you and I calling on God, believing on God, hearing from God, using you as a person, as a preacher, to be sent by God. And what we are proclaiming is for people to obey, not just think about the gospel. And Isaiah says, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith comes by hearing, not by thinking, but hearing. Hearing by the word or the rhema of God. Hallelujah. Every time, I don't care who preaches, I don't care who proclaims, if God is using them, you and I are hearing from God. Oh, come on, somebody. See, that's the problem, see. If you have preacher religion, well, if so-and-so's preaching or whatever, I'm going to hear. But what about God using your brother? What about God using somebody you do not like? Hallelujah. To talk to you. In fact, God is going to do that. Verse 18, but I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound went into all the earth. And the words unto the ends of the world. Nobody in the last days could ever say, you know what? I didn't hear the gospel. It went out to all the world. And if you don't believe that calling upon the Lord involves all this, and especially obeying the gospel, you got to realize that the New Testament are just quotations out of the Old Testament. Right? Because Paul, he was in Rome. This letter was written to the Romans. He didn't have the luxury to say, hey, let's turn to Romans chapter 10. It's being written. It's being recorded. So what is he reading from? The Old Testament. He's quoting, he that call upon the name of the Lord, it's a quotation out of Joel chapter 2. And afterward, it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. Notice your daughters. Well, I'm a woman. I'm disqualified. No. Hallelujah. God could use you. Let's get over our gender, although there's only two, male and female. Verse 29, also upon the servants and upon my handmaids in those days. What days? It's our day. In those days, I will pour out my spirit. Hallelujah. And if you drop down to verse 32, and it shall come to pass that those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered. That's how Peter was quoting in the book of Acts. That's what calling upon the Lord means. It involves the outpouring of his spirit. I said it involves the outpouring. God wants you to receive his spirit. Today, somebody shout today. How do you know you received the Spirit? Well, some people say, well, I feel good, I've received the Spirit. Well, that's good. I'm not going to discount that, but is that what the Bible says? Well, if I feel goosebumps or if I bounce off the wall or if I've been healed, I've been filled with the Spirit. But if the Bible says otherwise, won't you want to believe the Bible? Let me tell you that the Bible says otherwise. It's not feeling. It's not thinking. It's an audible sound. Everyone that received the Holy Ghost, according to Jesus, when he was talking to Nicodemus, that they will speak a sound. And that sound is speaking another language. That is a supernatural experience. You cannot speak English and Spanish or Tagalog or whatever your native tongue is at the same time. How do you receive the Holy Ghost speaking in tongues, Pastor? Thank you for asking. All you got to do is be thankful. Oh, that sounds so simple. Yes, it is. because that's really all you need to do. You need to be thankful to the point that you cannot express your gratefulness to God out of your own limited vocabulary. And at that point, gratefulness begins to be poured out of your heart towards God, and it's going to take your tongue and you're going to speak words that are not English in Jesus' name, and you're calling upon the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Paul, the Apostle Paul, had the same experience of Cornelius, and God used a man to preach to him. Just like God's using a man right now to preach to you, and God is talking to you through a man. You believe that. But you got to look past the man. As good looking as I am, as well dressed, got a new tie, you got to look past that. I'm adding some humor there, so some of you are like, what? But you got to look beyond that. Because it doesn't matter who God uses. It really doesn't matter. If your spirit bears witness that it is God speaking, you say, God's speaking to me, not a man. In Acts 22, verse 7, Paul recounts his experience of God using a man. He said, and I fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to me, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And I answered, who art thou, Lord? And he said unto me, I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest. And they that were with me saw indeed the light and were afraid, but they heard not the voice of him that spake unto me. Only Paul heard the voice. Because God was dealing with him individually. Isn't it wonderful that a man could preach and God could use the same words, but he is talking to you individually at the same time, differently, because he is speaking to you and I as individuals, as sons, as daughters, because he loves you so much that he wants to lead your life. He wants to deliver you. He wants to bless you. You don't have to convince God to bless you. He wants to bless you. He said, you that are fathers, that are evil or human or fleshly, know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more your heavenly Father? Oh, come on, somebody, would you believe that right now? You don't have to twist God's arm to be good. He is good. The root word of good is God. He said, and I said, what shall I do, Lord? And the Lord said unto him, arise and go unto Damascus, and there it shall be told thee of things which are appointed for thee to do. Isn't that the same as Cornelius' experience? Send for Peter. He's going to tell you what to do. And in verse 12, Ananias was the one that God used. And one Ananias, a devout man according to the law, having a good report of all the Jews dwelt in Jerusalem, kind of like Cornelius' qualifications, isn't it? But Ananias was afraid, because he actually said, Lord, don't you know that he persecutes Israel, and he has letters from the governors to basically kill people? And Ananias at first thought, God's sending me to death. God doesn't like me. He's sending me to go meet Paul, who is I'm terrified of him because he might kill me. And sometimes we feel like, Lord, are you trying to kill me? You're directing. No. God's leading you. God's ordering your steps. It might feel like dying, because it takes that for you to die to your will. Literally, when you really surrender your will, you feel like you're losing something, a part of you, because you are. But that's okay. Amen. Because when you surrender your will for his, your life is going to get so much better. Your life is going to be full of light. Your life is going to be the best life you could ever have on this earth, being led by God. These people's lives that we're listening and talking about, their lives change forever. And they're written for our examples. And so in verse 13, came unto me and stood and said unto me, Brother Saul, receive thy sight. In the same hour, I looked upon him. In verse 16, Ananias says, why tarriest thou? Amen. Arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. The word of God fits together everywhere. There's no contradiction. Calling on the name of God involves the gospel. And if you have not been baptized in Jesus' name, you need to be baptized today. Today. Well, I've been in church all my life, and so was Cornelius. Well, I've been good. I don't really need a Savior, really. I don't need my sins washed away. Well, Paul's sins needed to be. He was a Pharisee, tribe of Benjamin, a Jew, knows the word of God, was a lawyer. You need to be baptized in Jesus' name. That takes your humility. That requires humility. Well, I don't have any clothes. Well, we took that excuse away. We got robes. Well, I don't know. Yeah, you do. We'll supply the water. It is warm. We can fill it up in 5 minutes, maybe seven. It's warm. It's comfortable. Well, we have a hair dryer, I think. Comb. I mean, if we have to buy it, we'll do it. Because we really believe this saves people. I said, we really believe calling on the name of the Lord in water baptism, hallelujah, like Paul did, and find out later on like Cornelius did. He washes their sins away. Don't you want your sins washed away? Amen. By simply obeying the word, calling on the name of the Lord in waters of baptism. He washes your sin away. It just requires you and I to surrender our will. So calling on the name of the Lord not only involves water baptism, but the infilling of his spirit. God primarily uses people to speak to us. And once you get that and don't lose it, God will speak to you in other ways. Amen? God still speaks to us through the preaching of the word. That's why you need a pastor. You need a shepherd. You need a local assembly that you could join yourself to, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves, and hear constantly the word of God, which is living bread, because you got to eat regularly, right? I don't think I need to explain that in natural terms, but we need to eat regularly also in spiritual terms, and you cannot afford to have a malnourished soul that's only 80 pounds heavy. You know, soaking wet. Your soul has got to be healthy when that trumpet sounds. Amen. That's why the Bible says, where two or three are gathered together in my name, Jesus says, I'm going to show up. Or you can pray by yourself, but there's a multiplication power when we gather together in the house of God. Did you sense the Spirit of the Lord moving a little while ago while God prepared us for the preaching, when we were singing the songs of the Lord? Hallelujah. That's why he says, if two of you agree as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done unto them. Seems like God wants us to gather together. Hallelujah. And you've got to get this. Every time preaching goes forth and your spirit bears witness of what is being said, that you receive that as coming from the Lord. Otherwise, you're going to come 52 weeks times two if you come on a midweek. And you're going to be the same year after year. You don't want that. We don't have time for that. We're living on borrowed time. God could institute the promise of Abraham and fulfill it. And then he's going to come. He's going to end his age in Jesus' name. But we got to realize God not only speaks to us through the spoken word. God also wants to use you to speak to somebody else. Because that's how this world's going to be saved. So Cornelius sends for Peter. And Peter was a bigoted Jew. I don't apologize for that. The Bible says that. Because before Cornelius, there was not one heathen person
that was baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost, they were not even thinking about reaching them. Jesus even said to the woman, amen, that says, Lord, you know, I need your help. And God says, insulted her and says, it's not meat to give the children's meat to the dogs. And if you get insulted by the preaching, God called her a dog. And she did not get insulted. They said, yea, Lord, but even the dogs eat from the crumbs that fall from the master's table. See, if you're hungry for God, he's going to feed you. He's going to fill you. If you're thirsty for God, he's going to give you living water to drink in Jesus' name. If you're hungry to be saved, God is going to wash your sins away when you get baptized in his name today. Why Peter? Impulsive. Racist. Yeah, they throw that stuff around. It lost its meaning. This is real racism. Was Jesus racist? Because she called her a dog? Some of you are like, well, come on now. Does God love everybody or just one particular race? Did he die for the sins of a whole world or just one race? There's your answer. But see, it's timing. It was not time yet. During Jesus' time, he knew the time of Cornelius will come. But somebody's got to proclaim it. And you and I have got to proclaim it in Jesus' name. He's going to entrust people that you think you're not qualified, just like Peter was given the keys to the kingdom. Impulsive Peter. He said in Matthew 16, and I say unto thee that thou art Peter, upon this rock, not Peter, but the rock Christ Jesus, I will build my church. God is building people. God is building his church. You are the church of the living God. Your bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost. And you have been given authority to assault the gates of hell. Come on now, in your prayer time, realize the power that you have. Realize you could go up to the gates of hell and shake it in Jesus' name and tear it down in Jesus' name. Come on, believe the word. If you're not going to believe anything, that the gates of hell shall not prevail against you. So what have you been doing when hell comes against you? My God, you have more authority and power than you know. He says in verse 19, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom. Now Peter's dead and gone, but he was chosen to be sent to Cornelius because he was initially given the keys to the kingdom. Whatsoever you bound on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. But the keys now is given to the church. You have the keys. I said, you have the keys. Turn to somebody and tell them with conviction, you have the keys. And what are you doing with those keys? What are you doing with the keys? You heard it this past weekend. To whom much is given, much is required. And is there somebody there in your life, in your day, that's locked up in sin? And you have the keys to unlock it. And you just pass them by. That is not the will of God. You have authority. You have power. The gates of hell shall not prevail against you. And so Peter, amen, began to proclaim the word of God. But God had to deal with him first about his racism. Acts 10 verse 11, and saw heaven opened and a certain vessel descending unto him. This is Peter. And as it had been a great sheet knit at the four corners and let down on the earth. Are you picturing it? Wherein all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth and wild beasts and creeping things fowl of the air. And there came a voice to him, rise, Peter, kill and eat. And Peter said, not so, Lord. There he is again, telling God what to do. That God doesn't know what he's doing. Unless we judge him, we do that a lot as well. No, I don't want that, God. Especially when it's against your flesh, right? Oh, it's easy to say yes to, and sometimes that does happen when what you like You know, God empowers you because he begins to change your desires. Once you hated, now you love. Once you love, now you hate. That's called conversion. Hallelujah. It says, not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean. And the voice spake unto him again the second time. Someone say the second time. Now listen, this is how God speaks to us. Not only through the preacher, but when something comes to you the second time, God's talking to you. Amen? Especially when you don't want to do it. It comes again the second time. Well, I don't know. In case you wonder why I kind of pause and stutter sometimes because things are coming to me like the second time. They're going to get offended, Lord. Man, I don't know if they're able to take that right now. Verse 16, this was done thrice. When it comes the third time, you better do it. Because in the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. And so as God leads you and I in our day, when it keeps coming back over and over again, it's not just your imagination. God is speaking to you. Would you receive that revelation right now? In Jesus' name. Somebody shout in Jesus' name. Verse 30, Cornelius said, when Peter finally came to his house, Cornelius said, 4 days ago I was fasting. Oh, so evidently, when you pray, you also need to fast. It's denying your flesh. Until this hour, and at the ninth hour, I prayed in my house. And behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing and said, Cornelius, thy prayers heard, thine alms are had in remembrance in the sight of God. And he recounts the story to send, amen, for Peter. And he says, he shall speak unto thee. And he says, and immediately, verse 33, therefore I sent unto thee, and thou hast well done that thou art come. Now, therefore, we are all here present before God to hear all things that are commanded thee of God. He was not listening to a man. He did not send for Peter to hear what Peter thinks about a certain situation. He understood that God will use a preacher to talk to him. He said, we're gathered here together, much like we are today, to hear what God has commanded for us to hear. Come on, somebody, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why every time we gather, and no matter who preaches, that we hear from God, whether you like it or not. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of person. Oh, man, I realize now that it's just not exclusive to us Jews, that we're not so special after all. Oh, I realize now this is not reserved for just one race. I'm sorry, God, I was a racist. I don't even know why I'm saying that. But he said, but in every nation, he that feareth God and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. The word which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That word I say, you know, which was published all throughout Judea and began in Galilee after the baptism which John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all these things which he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. See, Jesus was crucified for your sins and mine. God had raised him up the third day, showed him openly to not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before of God, even to us who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be judge of the quick and dead. To him gave all the prophets witness
that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. When do you profess his name? When do you believe in his name that your sins are remitted? Is it not in the waters of baptism? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. And nobody in the Bible was baptized any other way but in Jesus' name. Yet hundreds of churches baptized in another way. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Father is not a name. Right? You get a brain, right? Father is not a name. Any fathers here? Well, I don't know. Do I have a kid? Let me try that again. Any fathers? Do you have a name? Shout your name. Notice there's only one father. We got a name, right? Notice Brother Paul didn't say father, because that's no name. Any sons here? Do you have a name? Yes, he is also a father and a son. And that's amazing, because that's actually an awesome revelation and illustration that he is one person, yet he has different functions. And so when they said, be baptized in Jesus' name, you are baptizing in the name of the Father, which is Jesus, in the name of the Son, which is Jesus. And he said, I send a comforter in my name, which is Jesus Christ. That's why you need to be baptized in Jesus' name today. Today. Verse 44, why Peter yet spake these words. The Lord said, That's enough, Pete. Shut up, Pete. See, when God calls you to preach, you got to know when to keep talking and when to stop. When God uses you in the preaching of tongues, you need to know when to begin and when to stop and not add your words. That you don't mix your emotions in it and what you like. Or use to correct somebody because you're... all right, I'll just say it. You're a coward. Come on. Right? So you pray for somebody, say, oh, my God, if you don't have the guts to talk to them face to face, don't use that. Hello? Well, Peter yet spake these words. The Holy Ghost fell on them which heard the word. Now, the Holy Ghost is invisible, right? Because you don't see a spirit. A spirit doesn't have flesh and bones. How did they know that the Holy Ghost fell or came upon them? And they, of the circumcision, the Jews which believed, they were astonished, as many as came with Peter. Oh, wow. The Chinese could receive the Holy Ghost. I'm using that terminology because I do look Chinese. I'm not Chinese. I'm part Chinese. Like somebody said, well, they said you didn't graduate college, high school. They said, that's not right. I only graduated third grade. Some of you got that. Also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. How? In verse 46, for they heard them speak with tongues. This is for everybody to speak in tongues. Hallelujah. Anybody believe it? It's for you to speak in tongues. Would you stand right now if you believe it's for you? If you believe it's for you to speak in tongues right now, would you stand? And if you believe it's for you right now, would you lift up your hands and would you just begin to worship the Lord? Would you just begin to worship the Lord right now? Would you begin to speak in tongues in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ? If you've never spoken in tongues at all, would you come to the front? Don't be timid, intimidated. Would you come to the front? Don't be afraid. God is a gentle God. God is a loving God in Jesus' name. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, would you come right now in Jesus' name? Oh, they spoke in tongues and they magnified God. That's how you can speak in tongues. You magnify God. Would you magnify the Lord right now wherever you're at? In the name of Jesus, come on somebody, would you begin to build an atmosphere in Jesus' name where you can magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he heard me and he delivered me from all my fears. Come on, let's pray for a little bit in Jesus' name. Just pray in tongues for a little bit. Just pray in tongues for a little bit right now. If you feel led to pray for somebody else, I release you to pray for them. Hallelujah. If you're not praying for somebody else, just pray in tongues right now if you would. In the name of Jesus Christ, just pray in tongues if you would. This is a safe place. You don't need to be intimidated in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lay hands on somebody beside you. If it's appropriate, then begin to pray to together where two or three agree as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be given unto them in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. And if you feel comfortable sharing it with somebody, joining faiths together, God's going to answer that prayer. God's going to answer that prayer in Jesus' name. I'm going to give you some time. If you feel comfortable to share that with somebody that you love and trust, a need perhaps, a miracle perhaps, where two or three agree as touching anything that they shall ask, we obey the voice of the Lord. We've sought his kingdom first. You're in an atmosphere that you could ask together, agree together, and it shall be given. Or if you don't feel comfortable sharing it, just find somebody that could agree with you and tell them, would you just agree with me? I'm going to pray for something, and maybe you have something too. And we're going to agree together. We're going to agree together. That's right. Go ahead. Share it. Share it. It's the will of God. It's the will of God to share it in Jesus' name. It's the will of God to be vulnerable in Jesus' name. It's the will of God where two or three agree as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be given unto them of my Father which is in heaven. Some of you are praying for your children. God hears that prayer. God, some of you are praying for your sibling. God hears that prayer. Some of you are praying for a situation in Jesus' name, something in your mind, something that you think is so insurmountable, a mountain perhaps that's been there. But I'm saying to you today, it's the timing of God that you could speak to that mountain and it shall move in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you now lift up your voice? And would you begin to let your petitions known unto him? Would you begin to cry out to the Lord Jesus Christ? He katalamaya nalaya, come on, somebody, don't cry just out of your humanity. Let the Spirit of God flow through you. Let the presence of God do the work. In the name of Jesus, get under his yoke and let him pull it through. Let him make it happen. It's not up to you and I to make it happen. God is the one. God is the one. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead in Jesus' name. Go ahead, it's happening. Don't stop in Jesus' name. Go ahead. Oh, God is going before you. God is going before you. God is going ahead of you. He's preparing a pathway for you. He is preparing a highway in the wilderness. Oh, springs, even in the desert. That's why pray. Pray one for another. Pray one for another in the name of Jesus Christ. Pray one for another. Go ahead, don't stop in Jesus' name. Go ahead, don't stop in Jesus' name. So you need to grow. God's telling you to grow. You need to grow in Jesus' name. You've been stagnant. You've been content being where you're at, and God's telling you you can't stay there for too long. You got to grow. You might have to let go of some people. You might have to let go of some circumstances for you to grow. But I promise you, in the Holy Ghost, as God is speaking to you, you will grow. And you will not regret it in Jesus' name. Trade it. Trade those ashes for beauty. Oh, trade mourning for joy. Trade it for gladness. Trade it heaviness. You're in a safe place. You're in a safe place in the name of Jesus Christ. You're in the safe place. Lord, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, after the Holy Ghost was poured out, Peter asked, can any man forbid water which these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? If you're beside somebody, would you ask them, have you been baptized in Jesus' name? Do you want to be baptized in Jesus' name? Would you ask them right now in Jesus' name? And in verse 48, and he commanded them. It's not a suggestion, it's a commandment from the Lord. Because water baptism in Jesus' name is needed for your sins to be remitted, removed, blotted out. And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. We got somebody that will be baptized in Jesus' name. Would you thank God right now? Would you thank God for confirming his word? Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. We thank God for confirming his word in the name of Jesus. What's the Lord talking to you about? What has he been dealing with you about? Would you hear the voice of the Lord? Has been telling you twice, three times. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Those of you that are still praying, would you come to the front right now in the name of Jesus Christ? Would you spend a time, a season in prayer in these altars? In the name of Jesus Christ. Yeah. Yori kandala bakatala yana yana makasatala. Yes, would you pray in Jesus' name? Seal the voice of the Lord that has spoken to you this morning.
Yes, and la yana 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 satalai. Thank you, Father. Thank you for confirming your word, Father. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Dylan.
In Jesus' name. Lordy Kandala.
Did they start the water?
The evidence is so.